Before we start with the formal function, formal seminar presentation, let me just give a word about the National Research Program on Plantation Development at CDS. As I coordinate this particular program here at Center for Development Studies, the National Research Program on Plantation Development, NRPPD, is a unit that is funded by the Ministry of Commerce. And since during the last 1 year, we have been conducting webinar series. This is the third of this webinar series. Issues that are of interest with regard to plantations, that's what we do during these seminars. And today we have Dr. Hrishikesh Mallick chairing the session, and Dr. Srikanth Kundu, who's going to present on a very serious issue, a serious concern with regard to natural rubber price, the predictability of natural rubber prices. I think the rubber board had been interested in understanding what is the possibilities of getting some kind of forecasting for natural rubber prices. We had discussed, in fact, rubber board marketing division had discussed with me when I had been there, and then later on with Srikanth, and then it's with their help and support that this work has been done also. Now, thank you all for being here. Hope to see you in the next version of the seminar also. Now I hand over to Dr. Hrishikesh Mallick for chairing this session. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, Professor Abhinav, for putting me into the middle. So my role here is very little. So just actually to provide an introduction at the beginning. So yes, it's a forecasting is a very useful tool that we know in economics, finance, and also in many other applications, ranging actually to weather forecasting and other things, so climate change and climate change. So it's a highly useful for economic policy and also many actors, agents in the economy, consumers, investors, so. But at the same time, it poses actually don't it poses a lot of difficulties. So it is a highly daunting task, especially in an environment actually which is characterized by a lot of uncertainties in the macroeconomy. Okay, macroeconomy. Okay. So also quality of forecast depends on actually on the range of things that is actually especially on the availability of informations, perfect informations, and so the also the so also the model. Okay, so the it's about the quality of the forecast depends upon the ability of the actually you know forecasting model. In the sense that whether it can be always validated in terms of actually you know assessing the model by whether it is able to track the past information. In other words, whether in the past it has been able to actually track the information, so the forecasted values, okay, derived from the model, whether it has been able to track the information in the past, okay. And also, so the forecaster actually tries to actually, you know, minimize that actually, you know, absolute error and other things while forecasting. So, so there actually, the model is, the the task actually multiplies when actually there are a lot many actually models actually before the forecaster, but forecaster actually has to rationally judge which one to pick up and which one will give actually you know better actually forecasting results. Okay, so there can be also you know the someone can predict or forecast actually over a long horizon actually comparing actually shorter horizon. Shorter horizon actually, you know, forecast especially that it is likely to, you know, result in a little actually, you know, little error. While actually, when you are predicting over the longer horizon, you are likely to actually face actually little actually more actually, you know, more errors in forecasting because of the reason that actually, you know, a lot of uncertainties, you know, in the climate. Okay. So like supply and demand can fluctuate, okay, there can be shocks which is quite unpredictable actually the time actually you know the time when we are forecasting over the long horizon. So Forecasting actually can be actually also conditional, can be unconditional. Conditional in the sense that actually when certain things we are not able to actually forecast about the future values, about its future values, okay, that which actually affects, which determines that the forecasted actually values, okay. So then actually thereby actually the forecasted values, okay, derived, the results will be actually conditional upon actually those actually changing actually conditions, changing shocks, okay. So that is one aspect that which actually while the forecaster has to be actually very very careful while undertaking this prediction exercise, be very careful. Besides that actually because actually for instance we did not actually expect the pandemic, the nature of a pandemic, how it is going to how whether it will be coming about and how it is going to affect before pandemic. So we had actually the Indian policymakers had projected the GDP growth to be quite higher, and it's almost touching about actually something 5 trillion strong economy by the year 2024-25. But actually now actually where so that is actually when we look at actually the figures, so where we are, where actually GDP is, so it is actually really soggy space actually we are growing, okay, and almost it's projected that then we will not be able to attend. So only actually we'll be able to attend by the year 2030 or something if there will be conjunctive actually growth actually produced by the Indian economy at the rate of 9% is 9%. So these are actually pictures, and again actually sometimes while modeling one has to exercise a lot of questions, okay. So basically here actually yes, I think Kundu is Dr. Kundu is going to talk about, he's presenting the results derived from the time series modeling, okay. So invariant exercises, he's comparing actually is comparing results derived from some sort of different alternative invariant modelings, okay. So one is based upon I think Riemann, and other is actually the little more advanced that advanced technique that is called PROPET. So that is useful, I think in the situation when actually there is the data is likely to experience seasonal fluctuations, so to take care of seasonal fluctuations. But I do not know actually whether that will adjust any kind of actually supply shocks and demand shocks in the economy. So we are going to actually learn actually more about it, actually how the alternative scenarios actually will be reflecting actually the price predictability of the in the rubber market. So talking about actually something about actually the rubber crops, so this is one of the significant actually major crops in the plantation, okay. So so it brings a lot of actually foreign exchange from the international market, as well as also it has got actually a lot of importance in terms of actually employment creation, as well as also output production production and serving the domestic consumers and other thing, it has a lot of implications. So therefore actually I think actually when before actually we begin, I think actually when Dr. Kundu actually he just the slide, he showed his slides, so you can think of, so it a lot of, I think lot of actually thinking, lot of actually effort has gone into it. So let us actually learn actually, so how he gets the, he projects the figures on alternative alternative scenarios. I do not know actually whether it's actually he has a lot of, I mean actually whether he undertakes a lot of assumptions about actually uncertainties which he can actually crop up in the future. Okay, so I will not actually take much time. So as usual, so the rule, the same rule will be applying here. The presenter will be given I think 40 to 45 minutes, and then it will be left to the floor for another 40 minutes. So with this, I invite Dr. Kundu to make his presentation. Thank you. Floor is yours, Kundu.
Yeah, thank you very much. So today I'm going to present forecasting India's natural rubber price. Now here actually what we have done, that is we consider different univariate time series model, and among this model we compare in terms of the out of sample forecasting, and finally we choose the best model given the available alternative and trying to find out the predicted values. Okay, so The overview of the presentation is like this. We'll give some brief introduction and then objective of the study, and we will present the model and methodology, then data, and then finally we will come into the empirical results. Okay, now in brief, the study basically advocates to select some univariate forecasting model, and if it is significantly contribute to the forecasting accuracy, obviously, and then to predict the future price of natural rubber in case of India, a set of univariate studies, as I have already said, that I have considered some alternative univariate time series models, which includes autoregressive integrated moving average model, seasonal autoregressive integrated moving average model, error trend seasonal or ETS model, or which is another which is known as the exponential smoothing. And I have considered a recently developed machine learning tool, namely called Prophet, and introduced by Facebook data science team. And we consider this univariate model, and all models utilize a series of daily rubber price data from January 2005 to December 2019. And then we compare the model in terms of the forecast accuracy based on the root mean square forecast error, mean absolute forecast error, and then finally we perform the modified Dival Merino test to check the forecast superior forecast predictive ability, and then finally we choose the particular model which gives the better forecasting among the available alternatives, and finally we will illustrate our real time forecasting for any practical use. So I'm giving a brief introduction why the natural rubber price forecasting is important. So natural rubber is basically a vital agricultural commodity used for manufacturing of wide range of product, and it has been found that over 40,000 production is basically produced from the natural rubber for the community use. And the consumption of natural rubber is dominated by its use in the manufacturing of tires from bicycle to aeroplane, and numerous other commodities like bales, hose pipes, and say automotive parts, and some medical equipment. So these are the major things which can be produced from the natural rubber. So all these things are very important commodities. Rubber, the production price of rubber is very important, because if there is a fluctuations in rubber price, then that can affect the production of other commodities as well. So apart from this production and consumption, there are 20 million families who are basically working in the rubber market, as per the World report says. And now, the low price of paid to the natural rubber is basically creating poverty of these families, and sometime in Southeast Asia, due to the low price of natural rubber, people are facing poverty and not able to purchase the basic amenities like medicines and so on. So this is one important aspect. Why a particular or in an accurate forecast of natural rubber price is important, because if the forecast of the rubber price is accurately predicted, then the producers can also produce accordingly, because there is a time lag between the production and when it is finally coming into the market. So the natural rubber has been used in many manufacturing products that I have already said that it can affect the natural rubber price, can affect the commodity consumption and production of other commodities. Now, apart from this, there are another aspect that is basically future trading. So if in terms of the trader in the future market as well, the prediction of the natural rubber price is important, because if there are volatilities in any agricultural commodity, then the trader who are doing the future contracts and so on, that they can affect from the volatility of the agricultural commodity like rubber. So to minimize the risk of the trader as well, an accurate price forecast is needed. So now I'm going to discuss how and why the natural rubber price is changing. So because of many reasons, the price can change. So one important aspect is the demand and supply mismatch, obviously. And apart from the demand and supply mismatch, there are certain other products as well. So like say synthetic rubber is now taking a lion's share of the market, and there can be some other thing like when natural rubber is basically a traded commodity between many countries, and if the currency value changes, then also the price of the natural rubber can change. So there are international competitions. So some other producers, other producing countries, if they are giving it in a lower price, then also in a particular country the rubber price can fluctuate, and that can depends on the productivity of natural productivity, say labor productivity of the natural rubber of a particular commodity, a particular country. So international competition is another important factor which can affect the natural rubber price fluctuations, and uncertain weather that is also affect the natural rubber production, and that lead to the fluctuations in the rubber price. So apart from this, there can be some long-term technological innovation. So if there is a technological innovation and that can lead to a higher demand in natural rubber, so that can also change the natural rubber price. There can be some cyclical movement in the economy, so that in the short term, so that can also affect the natural rubber price. And if there are certain other factors like future markets activities and market interventions, irregular demand, that can basically affect the natural rubber price. So now, given all these things, it is very important to predict natural rubber for future, such that the producer and from the trader point of view, it will be less risky to produce rubber. Okay. Now here the objective of the study is to find out the appropriate time series model. Now a number of empirical studies to forecast rubber price are there, particularly in case of world market, and the much attention is given to Malaysia. Forecasting rubber price in case of India is very less, and it has been neglected for many years. Now here our objective is to compare the predictive ability of different models in terms of out of sample forecasting, and finally identify the best performing model for natural rubber price, and after that, after selecting the final model, we can do a real time forecasting for any practical use. Now here to identify the best performing model, we have considered the following models: autoregressive integrated moving average model, that is called ARIMA PDQ model. So ARIMA PDQ model is basically a model where we are not considering the seasonal variation. Now if there are seasonal variation, so then we can take another model called seasonal ARIMA model. Now another important model emerges from 2002 is called error trend seasonal model or exponential smoothing. And now we consider another important model which is recently developed by Facebook, and the model is called Prophet. It is a machine learning tool by the data scientist of Facebook. Now, given these available four models, now we compare the forecast performance on the root mean square forecast error and mean absolute error, and then finally we are testing whether the predictive abilities are same or it is different of different models, so that the forecast ability test or superior predictive ability test is called the modified Dival-Marino test. Now, autoregressive moving average, autoregressive integrated moving average process to forecast time series modeling is important, and it has been used for many years. Say maybe last 50 years, it is dominating the time series analysis, where the model can be written as say phi p b into 1 minus b to the power d y t is equal to phi q b epsilon t. Now I will not go into the details of all these terminologies, but here particularly if I say that here the notation b is called the backward shift operator or the lag operator. Now if the model, if the time series has a stochastic trend, and if we take the first difference of it, then it will become a stationary process. Now given a stationary process, we can predict the stationary values by taking the lag values of its lag values of itself and some linear combination of the past error terms. So if I can write a stationary model in terms of its past value as the past error term, then it is called the autoregressive moving average process. And if it is integrated in the sense that the first difference is stationary, then it is called ADIMA model. So in our notation, phi p is called the lag polynomial for the autoregressive component, and theta q b is called the lag polynomial of the MA component. And 1 minus d, if the d is equal to 1, then we can say that this model is integrated or integrated of order 1. That means the first difference will become stationary. Now in the typical ADIMA PDQ model is not incorporating the seasonal variation of a time series data. So if really the data contain the seasonality, then we can include the seasonal term by including the seasonal lag. That is, if it is a quarterly data, then the lag of the fourth lag of YT will capture the seasonal component, and if it is a monthly data, then the lag 12 will or lag 12 24, this will capture the seasonal component. And so here we are considering a seasonal ADIMA model where the small p, d, q, these are basically order of d is called the order of integration, p and q, small p and small q is the order of autoregressive and moving average component, and capital P, capital Q, these are the order of seasonal lag. Okay, in case of seasonal autoregressive part and seasonal moving average part. So similar to the previous notation, here also we can consider small phi pb, this is the lag polynomial for the autoregressive part. This capital phi p is the lag polynomial of the seasonal autoregressive part. Theta q is called the lag polynomial of MA part, and capital theta q is the lag polynomial of the seasonal moving average part. Now the model, the ADIMA and seasonal ADIMA model, is called the Box-Jenkins process, where we have to do the fourth step, that is called the identification of the model, and then estimation of the model, and after estimation of the parameter, we can check whether the model is fitted good or not. That is, there are certain assumptions when we are considering a model, whether these assumptions are satisfied or not. So that we have to check, and if there is any possibility of improving the model, then we will incorporate it. And then finally, after selecting the final model, we will forecast for the future values. So as per I said that ADIMA and seasonal ADIMA has some lag component, and the lag values, the past values of the error terms. So how many past values we will consider in case of AR, MA, seasonal AR and seasonal MA? That is basically my P, small p, small q, capital P and capital Q, and small d and capital D, these are the order of integration. So whether the first difference is stationary or the second difference is stationary, so that is determined by small d. And if there are seasonal unit root, that means whether I have to take seasonal difference to make the data stationary, so how many difference I have to take, that is determined by the capital D. So given any data, we don't have any idea about the P, D, Q and capital P, capital D, capital Q. So first we have to identify the order of the model, and then we will proceed to estimate the model, and then we will check whether the assumptions are correct or not, and finally we will forecast. So this is called the Box-Jenkins ARIMA modeling steps. Now there are other model we have considered. So one particular model is called the exponential smoothing model. So exponential smoothing is basically very old model. It is started from 1950s, and after 2002, Hindman and et al, they have published a paper where they have modified this model, and the new model is called error trend seasonal model. So after introduction of or modification of this model is also can be considered as a competing model for forecasting, and the model can be written in this way. So suppose you have the time series observations like y1, y2 up to yn, so n number of samples, sample realizations are there. And we are basically decomposing this model in terms of the error, that is called also called level. So error component is there, or the level component, then the growth component or the trend component and seasonal component. So LT, BT, ST, these three are representing the error, the trend and the seasonal component. And here we are here as per the model says that every element of this time series, that is the seasonality, trend and error term, these are basically following some exponential smoothing type of model. So as per, you can say that LT can be written as alpha into something plus one minus alpha into something, so it is basically a linear combination. So it is the exponential smoothing model, and for each and every component we have the exponential smoothing type of specification. And after that we can have either multiplicative model among these three, level, growth and seasonality, or the additive type of model to fit the data generating process. So as for example, here we have considered an additive model, where additive model can be written as LT plus beta T into HT, H plus ST. So here you can see that the three components are added, so it is called an additive model. So if these three components are multiplied, then it is called a multiplicative model. So there can be different possibilities of this error trend seasonality model. So if I just look into the trend component, there can be no trend, or additive trend, additive damped trend, multiplicative trend and multiplicative damped trend. As for example, if trend component is additive, that means it will be only a linear trend. If it is multiplicative, then that means it will be an exponential trend. Now along with this trend component, if there are seasonality, so if there are seasonality, then the seasonal component is multiplied with the trend component, or it is added with the trend component, that is called that is denoted by this notation. So if it is AN, that means there is no seasonal component, but the trend component is linear. If it is say AA, that means trend component is linear and the seasonal component is additive with the trend. So there are different possibilities of selecting the model. Now, if we introduce the error component, then we can have 30 possibilities. So as for example, if I consider ETS MMN, that means error term is multiplicative, trend term is multiplicative, and there is no seasonality. So if I consider ETS MADN, that means there is a multiplicative error with additive dampened trend and no seasonality. So there are 30 possibilities, and to find out the best ETS model, we can use the information criteria such as AIC or BIC. Now there is another alternative computing model that is called recently developed. It's called Prophet. So Prophet is an open source software published by Facebook core data science team, and it is available in Python and R for forecasting time series data. So in it depends on a contribution model where linear or nonlinear trends are fitted with a weekly and yearly seasonality, and it can also capture the effect of holidays. Now, Prophet is very strong in terms of capturing the impact of missing values, and it in terms of capturing the shift in trend term, and it is also capturing the larger outlier. And in addition, it gets a reasonable estimate in the mixed data without spending manual effort. So it is very easy to fit a model using Prophet, and it is very easy to get an accurate forecast. So as per I just said that I said that there are linear or nonlinear trends that is basically automatically selected by the computer code, and the component that is trend seasonality, either weekly or say annual seasonality, and the impact of holidays, these all are additive. So we can write my model as YT is equal to trend component plus seasonal effect plus holiday effect plus the error term. Now, where it is generally considered that the trend is logistic. So Facebook has given some interpretation of the of consideration of the logistic trend. So they have said that say suppose in a particular region Facebook is growing and the customer of Facebook is growing, so first it will growing at a faster rate, and then finally it will be saturated, and when it will consume it will be same as the number of internet user. Now, in any reason, if the number of internet user increases, then there will be some another logistic trend. So they considered a logistic trend, but some abrupt changes in the trend line. So this abrupt change in the or the displacement is also automatically handled by the computer code. So this is the general idea to take to consider a logistic trend component. But if there is no saturation point, then it will automatically consider the linear trend. Now the periodicity will be considered as weekly and yearly. So the main difference of capturing seasonality of ARIMA model Prophet is that in case of ARIMA model, if I have a daily data, then by seasonality we mean only the day of the week effect. But here in case of Prophet, they are considering weekly seasonality as well as yearly seasonality. That means the day of the week effect as well as the day of the year effect. Now, if it is and they are also considering the within day variation as well. So the seasonality component can be written as some the linear combination of the sine and cosine. So it is basically a Fourier transformation, and by which they are capturing the seasonal effect. So apart from this change seasonality, the profit is also capturing the impact of holidays. Now, the data we have considered is from January 2005 to December 2019. It is the daily frequency data, and the data source is Indian Rubber Board. The data, the sample size is basically depending on the availability of the data. Now, if we just plot the rubber price, you can see that there are some fluctuations. So the data from 2005 to 2020, around 2011-12, there is a very peak in the rubber price, and after that it started falling. So by seeing the graph only, we can just consider that this is a non-stationary time series data. Now, if we just take the daily return, or you can say that rubber price inflation, or the growth rate of rubber price, whatever you can say, so the graph is graph look like this, and if we just plot the density function of it, you can see that that it is, the distribution is leptocratic, and the mean value of the growth rate is around zero. Now I'm going to identify the order of P, Q, and D to estimate the ARIMA and SARIMA model. So before going to this, we just plot the autocorrelation function against the time lag. So here we can see that there are high autocorrelation. And the autocorrelation is persistent, so it is an indicator that the series is non-stationary. If we see the partial autocorrelation coefficient, we can see that the first two partial autocorrelation coefficients are statistically significant, and then there is then all the other partial autocorrelation coefficients are statistically insignificant. So now the autocorrelation function in the change in natural rubber price is plotted here. So here we can see that the first, second order autocorrelations are statistically significant, and then after 10th or 11th lag, there are some few lags where the autocorrelations are marginally statistically significant. And if we see the partial autocorrelation coefficient, you can see the first order autocorrelation, partial autocorrelation is highly significant, and the other partial autocorrelations are somehow sporadically significant. So to identify the order of integration, whether the first difference is going to be stationary, or we need a second difference to make the data stationary, we have used the unit root test. To test unit root, we have used two particular tests. One is called augmented Dickey Fuller test and Phillips Perrin test. Both tests suggest that the label values are non-stationary. So the null hypothesis of non-stationarity cannot be rejected, and we can see that the first difference is stationary. That means the null hypothesis of non-stationary data is rejected at 1% level. So from the unit root test, we can identify the order of integration, that is D is equal to now 1. So ARIMA PDQ model, here you can see that D is equal to 1. Now the order of P and order of Q, that is identified by the AIC and BIC criteria. So here we have considered both the model suggested by AIC and BIC. So AIC have suggested ARIMA 414 model. That means we have to consider four number of lag in the autoregressive part, and only one lag in the MA part. And BIC model suggests that it is basically and ARIMA 11 model. That means 110 model, that means after taking the first difference, it is basically an AR1 model. So we have considered the ARIMA 110 model suggested by BIC, because it is the simplest model, and sometimes it has been considered in many forecasting models as a benchmark. So here also we have considered ADIMA 1.1 model as a benchmark model, and we will see the performance of other models considering ADIMA 1.1.0 as the benchmark model. Now, after identification of the PDQ, small p, small d, and small q, we have estimated the parameters. That is the autoregressive component and the parameter involved in the moving average component. So here we can here these are the estimated parameters, and the standard errors are given in parentheses. If you just calculate the t ratio, then you can see that that all the coefficients are statistically significant at 1% level. Now, while we have tried to estimate S ARIMA PDQ capital P capital D capital Q model, we have seen that there is no seasonality found. So the S ARIMA model is finally reduced to ARIMA PDQ model, and so obviously this will be same as the analysis will be same as the previous ARIMA PDQ model. Because why we have not find out any seasonality in the model, because as it is a daily data, so the seasonality refers to the day of the week effect, and here in this case we have seen that there is no significant day of the week effect. Now, as per the ETS model is concerned, you know that every component of time series, that is the error, trend, and seasonality, these individually are following an exponential smoothing model. It involves three different parameters. One is alpha for the level, beta for the trend, and gamma for seasonality. So here we have estimated these three parameters, and finally, after estimating all these models, we have tried to find out or we have tried to forecast some out of sample observations to see the forecast performance. So please note that here we have divide our sample size into two part. The entire sample given was from 2005 January to 2019 December. So we have considered last 6 months as my out of sample observations. So we have considered from January 2005 to June 30th June 2019 as my in sample analysis to fit the model. And the last 6 month observations we have forecasted to see the forecast performance. So if you just the figures are very small, but if you can look it carefully, you can see that the forecast from ADIMA 1.1.0, forecast from ADIMA 4.1.4, and forecast from the ETS model, all these three forecasted lines are basically horizontal line. So there is no variation in the forecasted values. Now, if we look into the forecasted value of from the model profit, we can see that the forecasted values are significantly different from the past three values. Now, as my out of sample observations are already given to us, it is with me, so we can now check whether the forecasts are good or not. Okay, so to do this, we have done some in sample forecast performance. So we have done two things. One is my in sample forecast performance, that is the sample size I have considered from January 2005 to June 2019, and what is the fitted value of different models, and we have the actual value. So whether the actual value and the fitted value are different or not, so that can be considered as the root mean square error and mean absolute error. So So here we can see that that the ARIMA 414, ARIMA 110, and the ETS model in all these three cases, the in sample error terms are more or less same, but the in sample error the prediction error in sample prediction error is little bit higher in case of profit. So both in terms of RMSE and MAE, root mean square error and mean absolute error, we can see that ARIMA 414, ARIMA 110, and the exponential smoothing thing, these three models have has given more or less same type of fittings. But for in when the in sample fitted value is considered for profit, we have seen that the predicted error terms is quite very high. Now there are some intuition why we have got high root mean square error and mean absolute error in case of profit, because you know in case of ARIMA 1-1 model, as for example, if we consider, you know, first it is taking the first difference to make the data stationary, and then consider the change in prices and fit an ARMA type model. Now once so it is basically, you know, the model is estimated taking delta yt, and after when I got the predicted value of delta yt, I can just add the yt minus 1 to get yt hat. So as we have considered the past yt minus 1 value, and we are adding it with the estimated change in the prices, so it's in sample fittings is quite very good. But in case of profit, we have not done this. Actually we have fitted an exponential trend, exponential trend, and seasonal component and holiday effect. So in terms of in sample fittings, we can say that ARIMA and ETS model are overfitted, at least in this data. But if we consider the out of sample forecasting performance, we can see that ARIMA 414, in case of ARIMA 414, the root mean square forecast error is 1903, and ARIMA 110 is 1912. ETS model gives 1919, while the profit is giving 814 as my root mean square forecast error. So it is significantly less than the other three models. In terms of mean absolute forecast error, also profit is giving performing better in terms of out of sample forecasting performance. Now I am coming to the previous slide, that in case of profit, they have just decompose the fitted value of the trend, the weekly seasonality, yearly seasonality, that the day of the year effect, that is for every January 1st there can be some effect, for every April 1st there can be some effect, there every March 1st there can be some impact, and so on. So the seasonal component is here is two way. One is the day of the week effect, and another one is the day of the year effect. So after capturing these two, profit is basically giving a better forecast. And another thing is that here in profit, they are fitting some exponential, some logistic trend curve, but there can be some abrupt shift in the trend component. So that is also automatically captured by this machine learning tool. So if you see the forecast out of sample forecast, then you can see that profit is giving a better forecasting in terms of the out of sample prediction. Now we have performed some another test called forecast superior predictive ability test. That means whether the root mean square forecast error in two alternative models are same or not. So here we need to calculate two different loss functions. So first loss function I have considered is the square predictive error, and another loss function is absolute predictive error. So in terms of the square predictive error and absolute predictive error, if I consider ARIMA 110 as my benchmark, and we have performed the superior predictive ability test considering the pairwise model, ARIMA 110 is my benchmark model, and ARIMA 414 is my alternative model. ARIMA 110 is benchmark, and ETS is my alternative model. ARIMA 110 is the benchmark, and profit is alternative model. So here we can see that the null hypothesis of the same predictive ability has been rejected in case when we are considering ARIMA 110 and ARIMA 410. So ARIMA 411 is a better model in terms of the out of sample forecasting than ARIMA 110 model in terms of both the loss function. Here you can see that the test statistics is negative. That means ETS is worse performing than the benchmark model 110, ARIMA 110. So while we are considering ARIMA 110 and profit, we are seeing that the null hypothesis of the same predictive ability has been rejected for both the loss function. Now, as we have seen that the ARIMA 414 and profit both are superior than ARIMA 110, now we consider ARIMA 414 as my benchmark and test whether profit is outperforming ARIMA 414 or not. Here also we have seen that here it should be the probability value, that is 0.00. there is a typing error. So in this case also we have seen that the profit is the superior model than ARIMA 414. So now, after it has been established that the profit is giving a better out-of-sample forecasting, so for the practical use, we have done a 365 days out-of-sample real-time forecasting. That means the data is given up to 2019, and for 2020, we have done a forecast, out-of-sample forecast. So here in case of ARIMA 414, when we consider the entire sample, that is up to December 2019 as my in sample, based on this we have fitted the model and performed the out of sample forecasting, which we have seen that the forecasted, the point estimation of the forecast value is a fixed value, the line is horizontal. But here profit is somehow able to manage the seasonal variation, and there are some fluctuations in the predicted values of the real time predicted values. Now it is the time when the new data will come, then we can check whether the real time forecasting was good or not. Different test and different criteria like root mean square error, root mean mean absolute error, we have seen that profit is outperforming the out of sample forecast. Now here we can have some possible extension of the from the daily data, that is to check the superior predictive ability, we can use a rolling window estimation where we can just consider say 300 observations as my out of sample, and then we can do some one period ahead forecasting for all 365 days, two period ahead forecasting, three period ahead forecasting, and so on, and check whether which model is basically performing well. So that I will do immediately, I think very immediately. And there can be some extension to predict the downside risk of the expected shortfall. So we can measure the value at risk from these daily data to know whether what will be the predicted value of the stock, say predicted value of the rubber price, such that the price will not fall below that particular value will be 95%. So we will be 95% confident that the price will not fall below a certain level. Okay, so that can be measured by value at risk. So we can extend our analysis to consider to estimate the downside risk, or the another thing we can extend from this daily data is to see whether the world rubber market is affecting Indian rubber price or not. Mostly Malaysian rubber price is affecting, Malaysian rubber price fluctuation is affecting Indian daily rubber price or not. That can that we can do as an as a possible extension of the model. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kundu, for an excellent presentation of the facts about the different results coming out from alternative time series modeling. Before I open to the floor, so something actually, I would like to clarify on certain things. But on very actually, I have very minor observations. So maybe which you can clarify me. this relates to when you talk about, especially when you talk about out of sample forecasting. So out of sample forecasting, is it actually beyond the period, beyond the data availability period, or it's actually still, because I did not get a picture actually which period that you are forecasting. So I did not actually, I could not be able to actually, trace out.
So maybe so first you tell and then I will give you that.
Yes, right. So the other thing is that by going with the economic rationality, which suggests that the model actually which better tracks actually the past actually performance, okay, the past values, okay, past actual values, we should rely more on that. But here actually, there is a little bit, I'm surprised that actually your profit model, it does actually good actually, it does forecasting in terms of out of sample forecast, but it doesn't do the same thing as you mentioned, that for in sample forecasting. So I am a little bit surprised. And again, the other issue is about when we model through ARIMA, so we need to check that unit root test. Yes, right. So then actually we model by using, if there is presence of a unit root, so we try to remove that unit root problems. We model through the difference of the very values, okay, of variables. But then yes, so whether actually the same difference values you have taken into actually consideration while modeling through this profit, or it is upon the level values. Why I say that actually, because you are talking about the profit model, actually this is super ability, predictive ability, predictable ability, okay. So you are talking, but then one is actually you are predicting based upon the difference of the values, okay, difference of the values of a series, okay. But other one actually I am not actually clear actually whether it's again actually on the difference of the variables that you are projecting, or it's just level variables. You explain actually, but you explain how, what are the, what, how it is in some equations, but I could not actually, I could not able to make out actually whether it is difference or it's level as far as profit, modeling is concerned. So, but then the point, whole point is that in sample forecast, it suggests that the ARIMA, ARIMA had the greater, ARIMA had the better ability, forecast compared to actually the profit. So, but then the point is that when we difference the values, we know that we throw actually a lot of actually information, so time series information. So considering that actually, then if you are not actually doing so in case of profit, okay, profit may be actually bridge that actually that lacuna. So I am saying therefore I'm thinking that actually when you throw out a lot of information, so maybe we actually it may not have actually better predictability, predictability. other thing that you were saying something that when it corresponds to the last pages of your prediction, there is some kind of a deviation actually, both in terms of actually out of sample forecast as well as also I think yes, I am little bit confused, or in sample forecasting there is some kind of deviation from the actual values, okay, values. Yes, so that means yes. There is a lot of errors in actually, errors in terms of your forecast. So so therefore it confuses, that whether there is something actually that we are leaving out to, maybe that we cannot be able to rely upon this invariant, modeling exercise. Rather, we should look for something structural modeling, where actually we can take care of where. Of course, it's not actually it's easy to say, but it is also difficult difficult to capture. Okay, because of structural changes in the economy. Okay, which determines a series. So therefore, actually, when that structural features change, so it definitely the variable that it will be determining that also will be is likely to change. Like SNS events. Okay, which may not be able to, which is not possible to take care of actually in this univariate forecasting modeling. So definitely, actually, it gives us a lot of ideas about actually which modeling actually is. Predicting actually in predicting in terms of as far as your in sample forecasting is concerned, and also out of sample forecasting is concerned. But I am not clear actually out of sample forecasting you are predicting actually for which which period. So that is my concern. So then so we I think you can also shall I leave him to the floor, or you will answer, you will clarify. Okay, maybe
first I will clarify you because the same question can come from the audience as well. So first of all, you said that you will not able to get what is actually in sample and out of sample, and for what period I have actually done the forecasting. If it is the real time forecasting, by real time forecasting it means that you have the entire sample set till today or the available date, and after that you are doing the forecast. So you don't have the actual observation to see whether your forecast is good or not. So for the academic purpose, to find out the model, what we are doing actually, we have a given sample, say from 2005 to 2019 December. Now I am dividing this sample into two parts. One is called the in sample, that is the data period which we will consider to fit the model, and we will left out some observations as my out of sample observation, and from the in sample observation we will fit the model. And then we will forecast it such that I have the actual data, so we can compare which model is good. So here in this case, when I am doing a forecast, seeing the forecast performance, so to see the forecast performance I need the actual observation. So that's why I left out 6 month observation, and we considered from 2005 January to 2019 30th June, that is my in sample, and last 6 months from June to December, say July 1st to December, that observations I have just left out to see whether my prediction or forecast is good or not. So this is called the out of sample forecasting, and the performance, the which model is performing good is called the best model in terms of the out of sample forecasting performance. So here, when I am showing this diagram or doing all these things, root mean square forecast error, root mean absolute error, and the superior predictive ability test, that is based on the in sample observation till June 30th June 2019, and then we have predicted for 6 month period, and as the actual data are given, so we can see the difference between the actual and the predicted values. So that is my out of sample forecast performance. Now, once the model is established that the prophet is giving you the better out of sample forecasting, so for the practical purpose, I am taking the entire sample as my in sample, and then I am trying to predict for the next 365 days, that is for the entire 2020. Okay, so that is my last diagram, that is my my last diagram. So this is the real time forecasting. This is the real time forecasting. Okay. Now this is one question. Now the second thing, what you just asked, that in terms of in sample and out of sample forecasting, ARIMA is giving a better in sample fit rather than profit, but profit is giving some better out of sample forecasting ability. So how it can happen? So what is the mechanism of estimating ARIMA model and predicting? That you have to understand first. What is this in ARIMA model? First, we are identifying the order of integration. So suppose D is equal to 1, that means the first difference is stationary. So that means yt minus 1 is a stationary time series. Let xt is equal to yt minus 1. Now I will fit some ARIMA PQ model for xt, and then I can have the xt hat. From xt hat, if I just add the yt minus 1, this will be my yt hat. So as at time period t, suppose at time period t I have xt, which is my change in price, and the estimated value is xt hat. Now if I just add yt minus 1, then I can get yt hat. So in that sense, it is basically giving the forecasting in terms of the level values. So when I am comparing or across the model, I am only considering the level values. But in case of ARIMA model, it is just adding yt minus 1. And in case of profit, there is no yt minus 1. Rather, it is a predicted value of yt minus 1 by some, logistic growth curve or some error term. So there are certain error in terms of yt minus 1 as well. So here in ARIMA model, we are basically adding yt minus 1 to get the level values prediction. But in case of profit, we have some estimated value of the growth and estimated value of the seasonality. So in that case, it is not giving the good forecasting in terms of in sample. But in case of out of sample, if you just see in case of out of sample forecasting, in terms of ARIMA, you have certain last observations and you have the parameters. So you know that it will very soon it will come to the average values. Okay. So but it is not able to find out any daily seasonality or say weekly seasonality, that is the day of the week effect, because day of the week effect is not significant as per the ARIMA says, right? So there is, it failed to capture the seasonal impact. Rather, in case of profit, there are two types of seasonality. One is your year of the week effect, and another one is the day of the week effect. Apart from that, they have considered some logistic growth curve, and it is if there is any change in the logistic growth curve, that also automatically captured by this tool, right? So in terms of out of sample forecasting, while ARIMA model giving a flat line, profit is giving a forecasted value with certain variations, right? So in that sense, profit is now performing well. So these two are your main questions. And the third question is, you said something about the structural model. So I agree with you that in case of univariate time series, you cannot capture the structural thing, right? So you have to have a structural, say, demand shock and a supply shock. So that needs at least two equations, right? So it should be more than two variables. Now, as it is the only time series model, only univariate time series model, you have only the past values and you can assume some trend and seasonality. So the structural shocks, yeah, it is the beyond of the scope. Obviously, we can do a separate paper to see whether the macroeconomic variable or the demand shocks, supply shocks, or some other countries' influence, all these are affecting or not. So that can be a separate study. So as there are some literature which talked about univariate time series and forecasting, assuming that the past values and the trend component, this says a lot. So depending on that, we have just done a forecasting model. Now, if these forecastings are useful, then obviously that will be good. Yeah.
Thank you very much for an excellent explanations on the question, on the issue that I asked. Now I leave you open to the floor, so questions are welcome. Please, either you can actually put your question. Yes, you can actually directly ask the questions. I shall request, but in case it's not possible, you can leave the you can write in the chat box.
Yeah.
Yes.
If specialists are not asking,
no, you are welcome. Yes.
Let me ask one or two.
Yes, that's right.
From the point of view of rubber growers, one general thing. In fact, first of all, I congratulate Kundo for doing this study. It's a very good beginning, and if the extension that he proposed, if they can also be pursued, then this exercise will be extremely useful for policy making and people in the rubber board. I'm very happy to see that rubber board is very well represented in this audience. There are senior researchers of rubber board participating. Now, one general question is about Malaysian studies, which Dr. Kundo mentioned. He mentioned that in the area of forecasting of rubber prices, we don't have a very voluminous kind of literature, but there are some studies in Malaysia. And it will be useful if you can comment very briefly about the usefulness of studies which are available in the context of Malaysia in predicting, in helping policy making, in helping growers. That's question number one. Two, we know that the natural rubber market is now highly globalized. Maybe 20 years ago, particularly before ASEAN, it was quite logical and correct to think about prices in India. But because of the WTO and because of the ASEAN, in fact, it's very difficult to speak about prices in India alone now, because natural rubber market is highly globalized. If there is a price difference in India, immediately imports can come. So, important to predict international prices, because international prices are going to affect without much lag prices in almost all countries because of globalization. So I would like you to comment on this about international prices, predicting international prices. Maybe predicting international prices will be very useful, because it may not be as useful as it was 20 years ago as far as Indian prices are concerned, because Indian prices are not anymore determined in India by supply and domestic factors in India, because supply and demand factors global that determine international prices, that immediately that will determine Indian or Malaysian prices. And third one, this is a very practical kind of question from a grower's point of view. See, rubber growers will not be, they will also be interested to know about the price on a particular day, say after 6 months, what will be the price, or after 3 months, what will be the price. On a particular day, what will be the price? Can you predict it for us? But they'll be more interested in long-term behavior of prices. They'll ask whether rubber prices related in relation to other prices, how is it going to move? Because now they are making long-term decisions for replanting, for converting, whether they should convert rubber into coconut or coconut into rubber. So for making such decisions, it's very, very important to know how the prices are going to, relative prices are going to behave in a sustainable long run fashion. And these are slightly different questions, but then as researchers, we should also be addressing some of those concerns. Let me again congratulate you for attempting this exercise, because it will be helping the growers and the industry. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Harlan. I think maybe you can give your explanations or something, and before we seek some set of
Rishikesh, my suggestion is that let him collect more questions, because now others may want to leave, because
we have already
external participants, if you you need to give time.
Okay. Yes, any questions?
Okay, then I think you can start
so I was thinking there would be some external question, since there are no, shall I ask one question? It's just that I have a similar concern like what Professor Harlal sir had already raised with regard to, lot of other variables that can have effect on price. I think that is a concern that everyone has been raising. Lot of other variables that can have effect on the rubber prices actually. So predictability, how far predictability for academic purpose is one thing that you can use the model to predict and see how far it is good, but in for the real world, if people have to act on the basis of some projections that we or some forecasting that we make, then how do we, it's a vague question to ask, but let me just ask, how trustworthy would it be, would this be this forecasting would be for a person, for a lay person to say that, okay, this, at least in the range of this price, I can expect this particular price in after, maybe after 6 months or 1 year or so, this would be the range at least in which my price would be. How far it would that a lay person would be able to make a decision with regard to whether to be in the market or hold the rubber for some more time, these kind of decisions. These are non-academic questions, but I think this is very important when it comes to forecasting issues. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Maybe you can address this, right?
Yeah. So let me clarify the Binod's question first. That means you just said that there may be some other important variables that can affect rubber price. So in terms of academics, we can go for univariate studies and so on, but the more practical thing is the practical thing is to consider other variables and so on. So yeah, that I agree, but I agree that if we can consider some other variables, and then that will be very nice, because multivariate time series can with this logic only, right? So obviously if we can do a multivariate time series where a lot of other variables will be there and the interactions and so on, so obviously that will be a good prediction. But as per the univariate prediction is concerned, we can say that when we are doing univariate time series, we are assuming that lot of things are basically captured by some time component, maybe the in terms of the lag values or in terms of the time trend, right? So when you don't have any other information apart from the series, then how you will predict the future value. So in that sense, when we are saying a trend line or something, so what is basically this time trend? Time trend is nothing but lot of other factors combined together, right? So you have the past scenario, past information, that a combination of all these factors make certain values, right? So that is my trend value, or that is my lag values, and so on. So in terms of this, you can find out a point forecast and as well as an interval forecast. So in the graph, you can see that there are some intervals and that the computed values are also there. So you can easily say that the probability that the price will be lying within this range is, say, let 95%, right? So as per I also said that we can just extend this study to measurement of the measurement of value at risk or the downside risk. That means if it is increasing, then we don't have any problem, but if it is decreasing, then that is a problem. So we can say that the probability that the rubber price will fall below a certain level, what is that probability? So in that sense, we can just say that there we are 95% confident that the data price will be more than that. So that we can actually calculate even here when we have just given interval forecast, that is also addressing the same thing. But here the assumption is the variance of the error term is fixed for all time. But if we do for the if we do something for value at risk, then we will assume that the variance for all time is not. So these are very technical things. Variance is not fixed over time, so that is changing. So accordingly, my value at risk will also change for different time periods. So that for the any worker in the labor market, or say rubber market, or any decision maker, so they can just find out the lower limit and upper limit, and they can have certain idea that the price can vary within this range. Like, you know, the professional forecasters are doing forecast for the inflation, right? So overall price level, they are also doing in terms of the univariate time series that the expected price level will be this much with certain standard errors. So that we can calculate from the univariate time series. Obviously, if we can consider the other variable, that will give us the other information, so it will be superior to that. One thing is this. Now I'm coming to the Horinal sir questions that I'm not considering this as a question, rather this is a suggestion, because I don't know much about the rubber price mechanism and the rubber board, and as well as what are the scenario in the labor market of the rubber plantations. I don't have any exposure. I in terms of the literature review, I read some paper in terms of forecasting rubber price in Malaysia and what they have done and what is the logic behind it and so on. So I will look into it whether these are even useful or not. And some other things you have you just raised, that is the WTO ACN, so price fluctuations, so this is related to the international trade as well. That is also I have to learn. I don't have ready-made answer that whether these international relations, how these are affecting and so on, that I need certain clarification, certain clarity. And the third thing that I am considering as a question, I can clarify, that is the more interested is in the long run behavior. So the rubber board or the other people's, like any individual related to rubber plantation, he can think about long run behavior of the price. Yeah, that long run behavior of the price can be captured through univariate time series as well as multivariate time series. So if we can consider long run forecasting, so I have done a 365 days forecasting based on the last 13 years data. Okay, so 365 days can be considered as a long run because it is a daily frequency data. So that can be considered as a long run. So apart from that as well, if we do some kind of multivariate analysis, and if we can establish that some variables have long run relationship, maybe exchange rate or some other international variables or some domestic variable and rubber price, these are co-integrated, or there is a long run relationship, then that can be addressed and your concern, that is, any individual is not thinking about price of a particular day, rather what is the movement of this. So that can be considered by taking some other variables. So that will be our next plan to do. That is, we have certain data on these things as well. So this is a project where we can do a lot of things. So here it is just a beginning. We have just done an univariate time series. Now, given the data, we can do some multivariate time series analysis with long-run and short-run behavior. So from here, we can understand what is the long-run movement of the price. Yeah.
Any more questions? You are welcome. So yes. We have 3 minutes left.
Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes. Please put forward your question. Yes.
Yeah. Good evening. I am Vinod from Colombo. Hello.
Okay. Yes. We could be able to. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Your voice is breaking, but yes, we could hear your voice a little bit. Not yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Opportunity, and first of all, let me congratulate Ian for making such a beautiful and beautiful on this aspect. And in the same way, I have one or two. I want to get one or two clarifications. First of all, I don't know why, what reason he has taken the time period from 2005 to 2019. 19, okay. Number two, and he has taken the Malaysian price as the base.
I given one thing just for the motivation. I just said that there are some studies on Malaysia, but here there is no base period, base thing considered as Malaysia. It is just to motivate the thing that there are certain. Certain analysis based on the Malaysian data, Malaysian double price data. Yeah, this paper nothing to do with Malaysia. And another question you asked, that is the sample period. So if you could
please let me complete.
Actually, I'm not able to
complete. Okay, I can understand. So we will help you that. Number price, we always compare the price of the price of
your sound is breaking. Voice is breaking. So if you have if your TV or something else is on, it's switch off that, so that will be more clear.
You can put it in the chat box, maybe, if you can't, if it's not audible.
Hello, is it audible?
Yes, right. Now it's clear.
Hello, is it audible? Okay, please. What I am saying is that we all consider the Indian price with that of the band.
Sorry, you're not audible at all. Can you please put forward your question in the chat box? So that will be helpful, I think. Hello? Yes, you are not audible at all. Yes, can you put forward your question in the chat box, please?
By email, please.
Any more questions?
Srikanto, I would like to, I did not mention this, but let me just congratulate Srikanto. It was a very good work. In terms of comments, I think the method that you have followed is quite interesting, actually. I mean, comparing across different models of forecasting, and then comparing samples from within the within in sample and then predicting out of sample and then finally fitting it in the real-time database. I think so that's a quite a structured method that you have followed in terms of forecasting. That's a standard way when you're using a univariate method. That I think that's a very interesting way that you have done. So the results also seems to be promising. Congratulate you to you on this thing. That's all I want to say. But hopefully we'll have more data and you will be able to extend it further with regard to multivariate also. That's a later point. Okay. We have some data. We have some data with you. You may be able to do that. That's why way of comments I want to say that. I'll stop it. Malik, you're on mute.
Yes, so on behalf of me, I think you have already appreciated the work by Dr. Kundu. So I thank him once again, and also I thank Professor Harilal for providing good comments and insightful comments, which will be useful. And also thanks, a lot of thanks to Vinos, Dr. Vinos, for his insights and also for asking me to chair this session. And I thank all of the audience for their participation and having patience to listen to this lengthy seminar, lengthy talk. Thank you, everybody.
Okay, thank you very much.